Good morning all. Welcome to the second class on this series of neurocritical care. And today's class is going to be on critical care management for better outcomes in patients with subarachnoid hemorrhage. And as usual, good morning to all of you on a Sunday. And thank you for joining us. Kindly keep your mic muted when you join. And you can ask the questions in the chat box whenever, whatever the doubt you have. In the end, we can discuss those things in detail. We soon will be joining by Dr. Poonaya and other experts in the field. So today's speaker for this is the same Dr. Saurabh Anand. He needs no introduction. He is the chief of Department of Neuroanesthesia and Neurocritical Care at Artemis Hospital. He is one of the most active member of Indian Society of Neuroanesthesiology and Critical Care. And he is the founder member of Neurocritical Care Society of India too. So over to you, Saurabh, for the class, and we are all waiting to hear to you. Thank you.
Good morning to all, and thank you, Dr. Prasanna, for the kind introduction. And I'll thank you all. There are almost 60-65 participants right now on a Sunday morning. So I think the topic itself will be quite intriguing and interesting. Okay, Prasanna, I am audible?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, thank you. So, I will take the baton from the last class only. So in the last class, I started that there's a stroke, and the stroke can be divided into ischemic stroke and hemorrhagic stroke. So one part of the ischemic hemorrhagic stroke we have discussed last time, that is intracranial hemorrhage, what to do, what not to do, and all those things we have discussed in the last class. And the recording is also available, so you can go to YouTube and have a look on that. Okay, so this time, a second part, second subset of hemorrhagic stroke, that is subarachnoid hemorrhage, we are going to deal. Now, why subarachnoid hemorrhage is actually different from intracranial hemorrhage, you need to understand that the treatment is different. How you approach subarachnoid hemorrhage is different from intracranial hemorrhage. So, what is subarachnoid hemorrhage? Now, aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage is a complex, I will define it as a complex neurovascular syndrome with a profound systemic effects and associated with disabilities and mortality if not treated well. Okay, I will always describe the critical care management of subarachnoid hemorrhage as a passing battle, a baton which is first now will be going to an ER people. They have to do everything right. Then the baton will be passed so that aneurysm should be secured. But when the aneurysm is actually secured, it is only one thing which has been taken care by the surgeons or the neuroradiologist or neurointerventionist by a coiling or a clipping. So only one part, that is securing the aneurysm, that is one complication, rebleeding, has been taken care. And if you look at this heads of Ravana, you can see that there are many, many more complications, many other things which can actually disrupt the prognostication of these patients, especially in a poor grade patients. So, but whether this patient will go home or not, it will depend lot and lot on the neurocritical cares and lot of these other things which have been described in this slide. So my focus will be in this lecture will be on those other things. Okay, so we need to tackle those other things simultaneously once the surgeons have started to take care of the rebleeding. So I'm not going into the details of how subarachnoid hemorrhage is going to be presented to you. We all know that subarachnoid hemorrhage present to you as a worst headache of your life. And one time I was listening to Prasanna and he was telling that it might be a worse headache than what your spouse gave it to you. So it's the worst headache, and this patient can present in any form of stroke, any form of stroke. So initially the things remain stable. As soon as the patient comes to you in ER, A, B, C, and then look at the signs. If there are signs of stroke, headache, you need to go to imaging ASAP. After the imaging, it has been decided that whether it's a subarachnoid hemorrhage, and the imaging modality of choice is NCCT head. And then you do a vascular imaging in this. There is no doubt that whether a CT angiography or an MR angiography or a digital subtraction angiography, any kind of a form of a vascular imaging you need to do. And then you decide where the aneurysm is, whether there is an aneurysm or not, what kind of location the aneurysm is, and then decide on the treatment modalities. So as soon as a person in the ER or an anesthesiologist reaches in the ER to do a pre-anesthetic checkup, he needs to look at whether the HNS grading, the Hunt-NS grading, what Hunt-NS grading the patient is in, or WFNS grading, or a Fisher grading. So these are the gradings which I am not going into the details. You are going to find in any textbook of subarachnoid hemorrhage. So we are going to start our discussion from when the patient arrives in a center, or when the patient is going to be transferred from that to a high volume center. Because believe me, when a patient is going to reach to a high volume center, it's going to change the management and the prognostication and the outcome of the patient greatly. So if you look at the literature, with aggressive critical care, surgical and endovascular treatment when they are used, functional independence can be expected in 40% to 60% of the patients with Hunt and Hess grade 4 and 5. Okay, so I will straight away jump to the scenario 1. We will discuss it case by case basis. So here is a 50-year-old man who is hypertensive, was admitted with complaints of sudden onset of severe headache and loss of consciousness, and admitted in some district hospital in Uttar Pradesh. On admission, he was conscious, oriented, and restless. His pulse was 100 and blood pressure was 200/100. NCCT was showing a subarachnoid hemorrhage, Fisher grade 3, with CT angiography showing an ACOM aneurysm. And they decided the patient should be shifted to Gurgaon. This was the CT scan of the patient. So what the people at that district hospital can do so that the patient should reach the high volume center safely? So there will be two interventions. One, the blood pressure control. And second is whether they can give some kind of a drug, some kind of an agent, so that the rebleeding does not happen. So the two interventions that might modulate this risk is the first is the blood pressure control. So if you look at this patient, what should be our blood pressure target? If you go back, the blood pressure was 200/100. Okay, so nothing needs to be done by 200/100 BP. Lower, if you can lower the systolic blood pressure by 180 mmHg, but keep mean greater than 90, you can lower the systolic blood pressure to 140 to 160 in this patient. You can leave your answers in the chat box, and I will wait for 2 or 3 seconds here. What do you want to do with the blood, with this kind of a blood pressure in this patients? Okay. So if I'm looking at a chat box, people are saying C, 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 those people who have answered till now, and more for a C. So see, as in the first 24 to 36 hours, there is high chances of rebleeding. So rebleeding in first 24 hours is as high as 4 to 5%. Okay. And so if you decrease the BP, there are more chances that blood pressure, the aneurysm rebleeding does not happen. But decreasing the blood pressure up to what limit? So there are no randomized control trial. Obviously, RCT is very difficult in this kind of a scenario. But you can take a clue from the ATTACH and the INTERACT 2 trial, which we have discussed last time. So they are for the intracranial hemorrhage. They are for the hemorrhagic stroke. So, but you need to interpret it cautiously. So in that trial, they have said that you can decrease the blood pressure to up to 140. Okay. But if the patient comes very early to do, like this patient, ictus has been done. Patient has been gone to some hospital. And for them, the chances of rebleeding in that very particular time on that very first day is very, very high. Okay. So in that say scenario, it will be safer to decrease the blood pressure to up to 140 or 150. Okay. From 200. But at the same time, if the blood patient reaches to you on a third or a fourth day, there will be the chances that cerebral ischemic events might have started to happen. So the period of delayed cerebral ischemia might have started. The period of vasospasm might have started. So at that period of time, that point of time, you need to take, you can be little liberal with the blood pressure. So your blood pressure can be little on a higher side, 160 to 170, depending on the situation you are in. So there is not one right answer for the patient, but depending on case to case basis, you can actually decide which way you want to go. Okay, so lower the systolic blood pressure up to 140 to 160 in the first 24 to 36 hours is actually safe. But Okay. So if you look at these three guidelines, most of them have been published around 7 to 8 years back. If you look at the neurocritical guidelines, you look at the stroke guidelines, you look at the cerebrovascular European guidelines, they said that modest elevation in blood pressure do not require therapy, but if you decrease it to less than 160, it is reasonable. It is reasonable. But if you look at the European guidelines, they are very blunt. They say systolic blood pressure should be kept below 180 mm of Hg. They have given a number. So most of the time, the number lies here and not in the guidelines. So if you look at the whole scenario of the patient, patient comes at what time, you look at the CT scan of the patient, whether the CT scan is showing a grade 3 or a grade 4 bleed, patient is looking in such a condition that ICP might be very high. So you need to take a clue from each and everything. Guidelines can guide you. There can be a rupture of aneurysm or an ischemic event related to high or a low blood pressure respectively. But this is how you take it. Now, second thing is, so the answer will be that in this particular scenario, in the first 24 hours, you can lower the blood pressure to 140 to 160. Now, if you go to the second thing, does antifibrinolytic help? Okay. So antifibrinolytics are alpha tetraspartic acid and tranexamic acid. So whether these things are going to help in these case scenarios or not. So if you look at all the previous studies, they were not conclusive. And what mistake they have done in previous studies were that they have started antifibrinolytic in the vasospasm period. So in the ischemic period. So they have come to the conclusion that poor outcomes outweigh the risk of prevention of free bleeding. So they were not in favor of starting antifibrinolytic. But if you look at in 2022 only, there was a one study which is published in Journal of Neurosurgical Surgery. Somebody's mic or video is disturbing. Okay. So if you look at one study which is published in Journal of Neurosurgical, they have started it very, very early and they have come with a positive results. So results on short-term treatment were promising but not conclusive. But if you look at the guidelines, the stroke guidelines have revised it in 2012. They see that for patients with an unavoidable delay in obliteration of aneurysm, a significant risk of free bleeding and no compelling medical contraindications, a short-term therapy with tranexamic acid or aminocaproic acid is reasonable to reduce the risk of early aneurysm bleeding. Now, this is a trial which is going on still. It has started recruiting the patient in 2013. It's an ultra trial and they are going to give tranexamic acid very early as soon as they receive the patient within 24 hours of randomization. So the results are still awaited. As I have checked the data last time, they have recruited around 900 patients. So we might get a result from this trial. But till that time, we can safely say that if your patient, like this patient, was in a district center in first 24 hours, and you are going to shift the patient to a high volume center, or for some reason or another, you are not going to secure the aneurysm right away as soon as the patient has come to you, in first 24 to 72 hours, you can give tranexamic acid. So tranexamic acid can be given before 72 hours, or you secure the aneurysm, whichever is earlier. Okay, so it is maybe useful. That is should be the bottom line. So in this patient, you can actually give for a short period of time. So now coming to the third thing, seizure prophylaxis in aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage. Should we just shake it off? So as I have discussed last time, that there was no role in intracranial hemorrhage. There was no role in ischemic stroke. So subarachnoid hemorrhage is also a form of stroke. So do we just stop giving antiepileptics? So if you look at the data, whatever you look at the data, it is very, very difficult to convince your surgical colleagues that you are not going to give antiepileptic. They doesn't understand the thing. They always say that if there is a fit, the aneurysm can rupture. But most of the time, what have been shown in the data, it's the other way around. When a patient has rebled, there has been a epileptic fit. So epileptic fit can happen, but giving anti-epileptic is not going to stop it. So it's like giving antibiotics to stop infection. Antibiotics are to treat infections. Antibiotics are not for prophylaxis other than a surgical prophylaxis, which should be for a particular time. So that is why anti-epileptics are not for prophylaxis. It is for the treatments of the epileptic fit. So, but with a period of time, if I look at my practice from last 15 years, we have actually giving anti-epileptics for a prolonged course of time. But now we have actually coming to a shorter course of anti-epileptics. So should anti-epileptic medication be initiated in this case? And the answer will be that a short course for 3 to 7 days till definitive treatment of aneurysm has been done. So this one, a recent study, which has been published in Stroke in 2016. I won't say recent, but 2 to 3 years back. This is the best what I can get in a recent time. So they actually retrospectively analyzed cases between 2005 and 2010. They come to their hospital. Between 2005 to 2007, all patients received prophylactic anti-epileptics. And after 2007, no patient received. So propensity score actually matched analysis suggests that prophylactic anti-epileptic do not significantly reduce the risk of seizure occurrence in patients with spontaneous SAH. So if you look at this, routine long-term use of anticonvulsant is not recommended. Another important thing is that phenytoin is associated with poor outcomes. So most of the time, it is the other way around. Phenytoin was the drug which was given for a longer period of time in the earlier studies. So most of the retrospective analysis were done with phenytoin. So they reached to a conclusion that phenytoin is not good. But otherwise, also, any anti-epileptic given for a longer duration is not good. So the answer is a short course for 3 to 7 days till we reach to a definitive treatment of aneurysm. So scenario two. So we coiled the aneurysm. The ECOM aneurysm was coiled. 3 days after the coiling, that is on the fifth day of the ictus, patient was slightly confused and developed slight weakness of right lower limb. So TCD was showing increased trend for mean flow velocity in MC and AC of both sides. What next? So if you look at the definition, everybody was thinking that now there is a vasospasm. So if you look at the definition of vasospasm, this is a paper which was published in 2009 in Stroke. And they said that DCI, that is delayed cerebral ischemia, is the more clinically meaningful definition then either symptomatic deterioration alone or the presence of arterial spasm by angiography or TCD. So vasospasm is a term which is restricted to the use of angiographic vasoconstriction. That can be in a CT angiography or a digital subtraction angiography or an MR angiography. Doesn't make a difference. So what is the definition of delayed cerebral ischemia? The occurrence of focal neurological impairment or a decrease of at least 2 points on the Glasgow Coma Scale. And that should last for at least 1 hour. So if you look at all the definitions worldwide, if you look at Three Idiots also, they have given the definition into two terms. One that is definition given by Rancho, that's a workable definition. Then there was a definition given by Silencer. So if you look at all those definitions, the important thing is, any focal neurological deficit after securing the aneurysm, which is not attributable to any other cause, whether it is hydrocephalus, whether it is a stroke, whether it is an embolic infarct, whether it is seizure, anything else, it is to be delayed cerebral ischemia. No, another important thing is that, see, this definition says that should last for 1 hour. No, last for 1 hour. I am not agreeable to this definition. Sometimes the patient actually present to you with some kind of TIS. Waxing and waning is happening to the patient. Sometimes slightest headache is happening to the patient. And it is an increase of headache from the previous day. So you need to catch it early. What's the goal? The goal is that the patient should not develop a permanent ischemic lesion, that is cerebral infarct. So you have to prevent infarction at any cost. Okay. So another important concept is that cerebral vasospasm is not equal to delayed cerebral ischemia. Now, what does that mean? So that means that majority of the research was actually focused on that cerebral vasospasm is the most important cause of delayed cerebral ischemia, period. But actually, when they show and they do the research, they say that it is not true at all. Because if you look at the angiographic vasoconstriction during the second week post subarachnoid hemorrhage, it is around 70%. But the clinically detected delayed cerebral ischemic lesions were only in 30% of the patients. Why rest of the patients were not developing the ischemic lesion? After subarachnoid hemorrhage, sometimes we see that there is a hematoma or a dense clot in the right MCA. And patient develops a cerebral vasoconstriction or a vasospasm on the left side. So why there is a different territories involved if the vasospasm is the only cause? So another important thing, nimodipine, which remains the only pharmacological treatment to improve outcomes after DCI, yet this benefit is not achieved with angiographic evidence of cerebral vasodilatation. So you need to know nimodipine is working by other mechanisms and not by dilating the cerebral vessels. So
Saurabh,
yeah,
1 minute. Can you remove those annotations? You have made some marks, no?
No, I have not done. I don't know how it is happening. I have not done.
No, if you go to options above your screen, view options is there. You can remove clear marks. One option will come. View options is there above your screen.
Clear
all drawings. Yeah.
But yeah. I have not made this.
No, when you move the cursor on that, no, it will come. Yeah, thank you. Continue. Sorry for intervention.
Okay, thank you. So, So, important thing is that it's a different entity and taken to be as a comprehensive thing. And not that only one thing is responsible for having a delayed cerebral ischemia. It's not moving forward.
Yeah, you can stop sharing the screen and again come back and share the screen.
Actually, the cursor has gone.
Yeah, now you can share again and.
So one thing which everyone needs to know is that entire picture of delayed cerebral ischemia is multifactorial. So I'm not going into the pathophysiology of delayed cerebral ischemia, but I always teach my colleagues and my students is that like sepsis is multifactorial, delayed cerebral ischemia is multifactorial. Like there is no magic bullet for sepsis, there is no magic bullet for delayed cerebral ischemia. You need to treat the patient as a whole. Entire picture is dependent on, there are so many pathophysiological events which are happening. There was a resurgence when there is a cortical spreading depolarization, which has been defined as a wave of depolarization in the gray matter that actually propagates across the brain at 2 to 5 millimeters per minute and which leads to depression in evoked potential and suppress the spontaneous EEG. And it is responsible for hypoperfusion and vasoconstriction. Everywhere there is CSD, that is cortical spreading depolarization. But if you look at everything, there is microthrombosis which is happening. Early brain injury which has actually happened at the time when the patient was admitted or at the time of ictus. So important thing is that you need to treat patient as a whole and you need to do something very right in a wholesome way and not dependent on only one thing. So this is a good slide as a pathophysiological phase. And if they see one thing which you need to remember is when there is an aneurysm rupture, there is a sympathetic activity which actually happens at the time of rupture. So most of the cardiopulmonary complications like increase in troponins, ECG changes, a neurogenic pulmonary edema, or a cardiogenic pulmonary edema turns out to be a neurogenic pulmonary edema later on. These happen in the early phase of the disease, decrease in cardiac output. All this happens in the early phase of the disease. Slowly and steadily, the myocardial starts to recover. But this delayed cerebral ischemia, this happens after a third day. For it peaks on a 7th to 9th day and then slowly, steadily decreasing in the second week of the illness. So that's the major difference. That's the major line in between them. So what will be our goal? So our goal will be, as I have already told you, that early detection of impaired cerebral perfusion. there should be a strategy for detection and confirmation of DCI, which should be employed. Okay. Now, coming to the management. So, management can be divided into what you do as a treatment and can you do something to prevent it? That is the profile access part. So, if you ask me that if you can do something to prevent it, I will say no, you can't do anything to prevent it, but you can do something so that the effect might be less pronounced. That is what I can do. So nimodipine, after that British trial, that nimodipine is the only drug which we all using from years. It has got a class 1A evidence and we are all using it. But you have to remember that the effects of nimodipine remains unclear and it seems independent of any action on large vessel angiographic vasoconstriction. So as far as prophylactic hypervolemia is concerned, hypervolemia is a big no. Prophylactic means as soon as the patient comes to you, start feeding him. Oh, start giving him fluids. So intravascular volume management should target euvolemia. I'm going to discuss what euvolemia is, because the definition of euvolemia is actually not very standardized over different literature. But if you look at this in contrast, there is evidence for harm from aggressive administration of fluid. But please don't carry a message that dry is better than full. So your message of your cup should be full, but not leaking or not over full, but it should not be half empty in this case scenario at all. Okay. So it should not be practiced. So if you look at how you are going to monitor your patient in delayed cerebral ischemia, most important thing in good grade patients, those patients who are good grade, not intubated, not on ventilator, able to respond to your commands, is a clinical. Now, what you do in a clinical monitoring, apart from doing a GCS monitoring, which the staff is doing for you, you need to tell the staff that what you need to be looking at. Supposing there is an ACOM aneurysm, there's a bleed in that territory only, you need to tell the staff, please look at the power of the lower limbs. Please ask the signs or symptoms which are related to frontal lobe. Ask them whether where are you, who are you, your name, where do you live. So all those things, subtle sign, definitely a patient going to give you once the patient is developing that cerebral ischemia. If the patient is a right MCA in aneurysm, the major clot is on their side, tell the staff to monitor the power of the left side. The patient on the left side, tell them to monitor the speech of the patient. So these are subtle sign. Subtle things which supposedly you came yesterday evening and see that the patient is doing fine, responding each of your command. In the morning, the patient is slightly confused. So you need to put your TCD probe at that time. You need to see whether your velocities are increasing or not. So neurological monitoring in a good grade patient is very, very, very important, I will say. Now, rest of the monitors, the most important monitor and the most handy monitor, and I think which is made for subarachnoid hemorrhage, is transcranial Doppler. So if you go back to the history, your patient has got an increased TCD velocity and focal deficit was not there. Now, if you look at this ECG of this patient, you see that in the ACA territory, the velocities are increasing. And if you look at the MCA territory also, the velocities are increasing. In this video, you can just make it out from the sounds as well, that your velocities are on an increasing. But one more thing I want to emphasize, vasospasm is not always about increasing velocities. It's like a snapshot is not going to tell you much about the patient details. It's always a full picture. So if you are doing transcranial Doppler from the time the patient is arrived, so you need to know the baseline velocities. You need to know the baseline pulsatility index. You need to know what was the diastolic flow. You need to have a signature of the patients. Signature of the patient means as a transcranial Doppler signature. So what was the flow velocity curve of that patient? So if that curve is showing that diastolic velocities are decreasing, your PIs are increasing, so there might be a chances of hydrocephalus, which is there if it is in every vessel. But if it is in a particular territory, suppose you are insulating an A1 of right side and it is showing a increasing of pulsatility index, you are insulating on the left side and the pulsatility index is absolutely normal. So there might be a distal spasm on the A2 territories. So which, because A2, you are not going to insonate directly on the transcranial Doppler. So there might be some indirect evidence. Like in this case, if you look at this velocity, you see the pulsatility index is increased. It is increased to 1.4. Look at the diastolic velocity. It is decreased in this patient in the MCA. But if you look at the AC territory in this patient, see, the signature is changing. So when... So what I mean to infer from these things is that don't look at only one thing. That velocity is more than 120 to 150, or it's a mild spasm. 150 to 200, it is moderate spasm. More than 200, it is severe spasm. Now you look at the Lindgren ratio and you see that it is more than 6, or it is a severe spasm. Yes, definitely there is a point in that. But at the same time, when you are not finding any of these, don't think that the patient can't go into a spasm. If you're not finding increased velocity in the transcranial Doppler, your patient can still go into cerebral vasospasm by different means. So you need to know all those things, but you can only do it once you are looking at a complete picture of transcranial Doppler. So what are the poor prognostic factor on transcranial Doppler? So we have discussed that. Important is, suppose there is an early rise of mean flow velocity on day 3 itself. You know now this patient is going to suffer from this vasospastic episode for a longer period of time. Instead, if a patient develops this kind of an episode on a day 9 or day 10, okay, if he's in a severe vasospasm according to Lindegaard ratio, and if the pulsatility index, see, if the pulsatility index is more than 1.2 due to increased intracranial pressure hydrocephalus, or maybe due to distal spasm, which we have already discussed. So, monitoring cerebral vasospasm, how much we can rely on transcranial Doppler? If you look at this publication, which is from Dr. Hemant only, from PGI Chandigarh, the data in the review has been consolidated based on their research, and they conclude that TCD appears to be reasonable for monitoring of vasospasm in MCA. It reliably predicts the absence or presence of clinically significant vasospasm. Routine daily measurement of TCD they have advocated. But look at other things as well. If you're not doing transcranial Doppler, what other things you can do? If you look at CT angio or CT perfusion, you do it both together. Cerebral blood flow of less than 25 ml or a mean transit time of more than 6.5 seconds or both indicates that there is a vasospastic episode going here. If you look at the angiographic suite, take the patient to an angiographic suite and do a digital subtraction angiography, or a CT angiography. If their vessel narrowing is more than 70% from the baseline, some say more than 50% from the baseline. So it's sometimes a visual inspection only, like you do in an echocardiography. So this can also define a angiographic cerebral vasospasm. Maybe also, if there is a reduced alpha variability, it can define that. So important thing is, if you use multimodal neuromonitoring, it may be good complement to your ICP, CPP monitoring, which you can do if there is an EVD in C2 already, and your transcranial Doppler, which is I will say a must in a subarachnoid hemorrhage. So if I look at the transcranial Doppler and will form a protocol according to transcranial Doppler, what will be there? If there is a mild to moderate spasm with focal deficit, you can shift the patient directly to DSA lab for chemical angioplasty or a balloon angioplasty. But if your patient is showing without focal deficit, mild to moderate increase in TCD velocity, you can do other means, which we are going to discuss in subsequent slide. But if there's a severe vasospasm in transcranial Doppler with or without focal neurological deficit, so you can straight away go to your DSA lab. So there have been numerous studies which have been pointed out at the pathophysiology. They take a clue from the pathophysiology, like clozosentan, endothelin receptor antagonist. They say that endothelin receptors are marker for inflammation. You block them, you are able to get a magic bullet. You take magnesium, you are going to infuse magnesium and cause hypermagnesemia, and you are going to get a result because it's a calcium channel blocker. It's going to vasodilate the arteries. But all these trials are actually failed. So what they are telling us, that there is no magic bullet, and they are telling us what not to do. What you can do is to form a protocolized management. So if you want to save life, I always tell that if you want to save life, you have to do the basic right. If you are doing the basics right in your most of the time you are caring for patient, any patient, then you are going to save more lives. So these are the trials which I have just listed for the residents. Conscious 1, 2, 3 about the clazosentan. STARCH trial is about the simvastatin, that is the statins. Then IMASH is about the magnesium. LUMUS trial is about the lumbar drain. The early drain trial is still going on. I haven't seen the results of early drain trial till now. Then there's albumin subarachnoid hemorrhage. The first part is a little bit successful with a higher dose of albumin, and they say that it is protective against cerebral vasospasm. Albumin subarachnoid hemorrhage part 2, the results are going to be published very soon, or I think they have made be published. So we now come to the management part. The prophylactic part we have discussed, now we come to the management part. So for years we were using triple H: hypertension, hypervolemia, and hemodilution. Triple H was the cornerstone for the delayed cerebral ischemia. As soon as you have a patient, increase the blood pressure, give fluids, hemodilute the patient, keep the hemoglobin up to 7. These are what we were doing for the years. But over a period of time, management, or I will say the motherhood of Triple H, has been questioned, seriously questioned. So does role of Triple H in the management of DCI is still there? You can say that there is definitely a beneficial role. Second, role of hypervolemia is definitely there along with hypertension, but hemodilution is gone. Third is increasing or stabilizing systemic arterial pressure and avoidance of hypovolemia. Or you can say that there is no role of triple H therapy. You can choose and put your answers in the chat box. So if I look at the chat box, most of the people are choosing the option C. So increasing or stabilizing systematic arterial blood pressure of hypovolemia. So why this has happened? So if you look at the study, a meta-analysis which was done found no good evidence for a positive effect of triple H therapy or any of its component on cerebral blood flow after subarachnoid hemorrhage. There was one study which was actually stopped in between Himalayas study, which was stopped in between. We are not thinking that any in the near future you are going to get any randomized control trial about triple H. So, and if you look at those guidelines, which is published in 2011 and 2012, so prophylactic hypervolemia is not recommended in any of the guidelines. Induction of hypertension is recommended for patients with delayed cerebral ischemia. So, and the second important thing is maintenance of euvolemia and normal circulating blood volume is recommended to prevent delayed cerebral ischemia. So, only H in triple H is hypertension. So, that is a reasonable step. Now, how you achieve hypertension is another thing. So, most of the vasopressors which have been recommended is then is noradrenaline or phenylephrine. The reason might be brain lacks alpha 1 receptors, so there is no vasoconstriction in the brain vessels. And second importantly, I will say that the most titratable effect have been achieved with these two drugs. Okay, but how do you achieve that? What blood pressure you stop? What blood pressure is the target you should choose? So I will say that it will comes with the clinical practice. You can choose MAP as a guideline. You can choose systolic blood pressure as a guideline. There is nothing which describes that in the literature, which blood pressure should you choose. But always see the baseline blood pressure which the patient comes in. And start, after aneurysm has been secured, start raising it slightly. Raise it to 20, 25 mm of Hg and see the effect. See the neurological improvement in the patient. See your transcranial Doppler velocities. If your patient improves, it's well and good. Otherwise, read it further. So 160, 180, 200. It should be in a stepwise manner. And in that stepwise manner, you always check for the neurological status of the patients. And if it is not improving and your patient is still deteriorating, rush the patient to the DSA lab and see what's happening in the vessels. Okay. The second most important thing is the euvolemia. Now, euvolemia is easier said than practice. How do you know that your patient is euvolemic? How do you know? So I will say that you can know that your patient is euvolemic by doing a meticulous work. Now, meticulous work involves, you see, intake and output of the patient. You see whether your patient's IVC is full, empty, variable. You look at the central venous pressure. If you have put a central venous line for a craniotomy, don't just remove it on a second day. Just look at the numbers. Look at what is the trend. What is the trend of central venous pressure? And add 1+1 always into it. 1+1 in monitoring always make it an 11 and not make it 2 always. So remember to monitor it in a diligent way. Always look at, if you look at the IVC, you look at the CVPs, you look at the stroke volume variation, you look at the end-diastolic volumes in echocardiography. If you have a probe, you can go for an echo as well with IVC. So all those things will give you an idea whether your patient is euvolemic or your patient is behind fluids. That's the most important thing. So increasing blood pressure is sensible. Keeping your patient euvolemic is sensible. You're keeping your patient hypervolemic, your IVC is fully dilated, then you need vasoconstrictions to increase the blood. So you should always remember that I have mentioned that in the previous few minutes back as well, that cup should be full. I don't want audience to get that message that drier is better than full. Slightly overfill cup is much better than a drier, including that your cardiac actually status doesn't preclude that fullness of the cup. So this you should take always in mind. So look at all these things. But supposedly, you know, your patient of delayed cerebral ischemia does not improve with your blood pressure augmentation. So you have put a patient on NOR-EDR. Whether you put your patient on a dobutamine or a milrinone in this kind of a scenario, yes or no? So see, if you look at the patient, if your patient is your relative, you say, okay, I have tried triple H, I have given hypertension, my patient is euvolemic. No, patient is not improving. I'm not in a setup in which a patient can be vasodilated in the night. So I'm sitting, I have done what I can done. No, you need to go further aggressively, increase the blood pressure further, increase the cardiac output. So if you look at this protocol, which has been published in Montreal Hospital in Canada, they started milrinone at a dose of 0.5 microgram per kg per minute and increased up to 1.5 microgram per kg per minute. And they have recommended that in their protocol. So inotropy, if the patient with delayed cerebral ischemia do not improve with blood pressure augmentation, a trial of inotropic therapy may be considered, and I will say should be considered. Inotropes with prominent beta 2 agonist property may lower the mean arterial pressure for a subsequent, we all know that, and that time you might require to increase the vasopressor dose. So further, in this patient we also done the same. Noradrenaline was used to increase the blood pressure, milrinone was also added in the form of inotropic support, but patient improves for a short period of time but again deteriorated and developed lower limb weakness. Now what to do? So straight away you shift the patient to angiography suit and detect whether there is a cerebral vasospasm there or not. But I always say, and a word of caution here is, please do a CT scan before shifting the patient to your angiography suit, because most of the time there might be an hydrocephalus which is developing, there might be a cerebral edema, and you start vasodilating that patient which is going to have a cerebral edema, you will be in a soup. You might already develop an infarct. There might be a dense weakness on one side of the limb, suppose the lower limb in AECOM aneurysm, and you see a well-developed infarct. So there is no point in dilating that patient. So always go and have a look at the CT scan before you rush your patient to DSA lab. So what next? So we have done the DSA of this patient, and if you look at the ACA territories have been spastic, MCA territory was also spastic, and we give nimodipine and milrinone. And nimodipine 3 milligram and milrinone can be given 8 milligram intra-arterially in every territory. And so when you are giving this, what is the most important thing? I know that most of the people are anesthesiologists here, so I just a little bit mention about the intra-arterial therapy. When you give chemical angioplasty to these patients, that is nimodipine and milrinone, most of the time the blood pressure starts falling in the DSLR. Don't worry about that. Start giving noradrenaline. Start, if you want to add vasopressin at that time, you might to go to a supramaximal doses of noradrenaline or vasopressin, add some fluid boluses to it, and you need to maintain the pressure somehow in the DSA lab, because these drugs are short acting drugs. They are going to be vanished from the system very soon, because that is why when you dilate with intra-arterial milrinone, you put the patient on IV milrinone in the neurointensive care unit as well. So use those vasopressors to maintain the blood pressure, because we need to tide over this crisis for a particular period of time. Once this crisis is over, we have seen that blood pressure has been recovered, patient is good, patient is moving both the legs. So that is what has happened with the patients, and that is what I have published in a protocol for cerebral vasospasm in Journal of Neurosurgery as well. So what is our institutional protocol? So a following standard protocol of care is applied to all the patients. On admission, they receive nimodipine. We maintain euvolemia, as I have already informed. If the patient is on a ventilator and wants to put a RILS tube, we give nimodipine through RILS tube only. We don't use IV nimodipine. After securing the aneurysm, if the patient is on a grade 3 or a grade 4 and there are high chances of developing cerebral vasospasm, we just start increasing the blood pressure, and we maintain the blood pressure on the previous the patient with the blood pressure was at the time of admission, and just raise it to 10 to 15%. Okay, norepinephrine is the most common vasopressor which we used, and every day at least 2 to 3 times we do a transcranial Doppler in every patients who develop a suspicion of cerebral vasospasm. Despite our standard treatment therapy, we put the patient on, along with the increment in the blood pressure, put the patient on milrinone. But if the patient develops a focal neurological deficit at any point of time, we skip all the step and shift the patient to DSA lab at the same time and give the doses which I have mentioned already of the nimodipine and milrinone. Now, sometimes the patient is so vasospastic, and sometimes what happens, these drugs I have told you are the short acting drugs, so they have just vanished from the system. We need to give these drugs continuously, because you take the patient from the DSA lab, dilated patient starts moving his or her legs, and then we bring the patient back to neurocritical care unit. After 2 or 3 hours, patient again develop that kind of a symptom. So what to do? If you are unable to achieve a constant recovery with dilators, what we do in our setup is that we put a microcatheter in situ. If you look at this microcatheter, this is in a continuous dose. We have made through pressure bags nimodipine and milrinone, and they are going constantly. We make an infusion for 24 hours, and after 24 hours, generally the bag is changed, and we maintain it through a continuous infusion of vasodilators which are going into the system. That is also we have published. So that is our protocol. In US, they generally prefer to do balloon angioplasties more often, but in our institute, we prefer a chemical angioplasty, and we are getting those results. Now, in the last scenario, you have done your chemical angioplasty. You are dilating the patient constantly, but still your patient is having kind of a malignant spasm. Now what you can do? So you can sit back and say that I have just used everything which was in my armory, and now I can't do anything. But at the same time, look at other scenarios, whether your patient is anemic. See, if you look at what is happening inside the patient system, patient is not well. You know that arteries are narrowed. Now, arteries are narrowed, there is a fixed stenosis, and there is a decreased oxygen delivery to the brain. So you need to increase it. You are doing vasodilators and trying to increase it. Now, what about the oxygen delivery? If you look at the age-old critical care equation, hemoglobin into SaO2 into PaO2 into cardiac output, so there are variables. You can increase the cardiac output. You are doing it with milrinone, with drugs, but you can do it with IABP as well. So people have tried going ahead in these kind of a scenario. These are very few patients. I will say that if 100 patients goes into cerebral vasospasm, there are only 2 or 3 of these kind of a patients which actually require this kind of a therapy. There is no evidence. So no evidence doesn't mean there is no treatment. Three years back, we are not doing mechanical thrombectomy before diffuse trials have come in our way and extended the treatment up to 24 hours. So before that, what you can say that you have missed the treatment on those patients in which you are not doing mechanical thrombectomy. So the treatment might come in and trial might show something in the coming weeks or coming months or coming years. But you need to do what you can't do for your patients. No evidence, I will always say, doesn't mean any treatment. So if you look at IABP, there are two trials. In this, there is five patients and all five have shown improvement. And if you look at these patients, they are used 35 patients in each group. And they say that IABP does not improve perfusion index or confer any clinical benefit. So people have used nicardipine implants. People have put a EVD and do a cisternal thrombolytics with TPAs. So people have tried each and everything. So try to maintain the homeostatic environment of the brain. No hyperglycemia, no hypoglycemia. Fever should be maintained. No hyponatremia, no hypernatremia in these patients. So overall, if you maintain the homeostatic environment of the brain, along with that, you are doing most of the things which we have discussed. You are most of the time able to tide off this crisis. So after discussing that things in detail preoperatively and the delayed cerebral ischemia, I told you that most of the time in the initial period of time, you have cardiac complications in these patients. And these patients might develop cardiac complications. So look at this patient. He's a 55-year-old male, known case of hypertension. He develops a complaint of severe headache and loss of consciousness. NCCT head shows a SAH, which is rate 3. I'm not going into that. Patient was on ventilator. On admission, her blood pressure was 85/60. Her sodium was 119. So hyponatremic. Hemoglobin was 8, anemic, and the blood pressure was low. And this was the X-ray of the patient. So this is the patient, kind of patients which you are going to see in the initial phase of the patient. As soon as the ictus has been developed, some of the patients, almost 20% of the patients, the literature says, goes into this kind of the picture. Now we say that it's a neurogenic pulmonary edema. So what does it has done? Increasing sympathetic activity and excessive catecholamine release has happened. And they result in vasoconstriction, severe vasoconstriction, and result in cardiopulmonary complications. So what is the real thing which is happening? I have just made a flowchart myself. So if you look at this, there's a subarachnoid hemorrhage which has happened. Catecholamine surge is there. Now catecholamine surge has done, the alpha receptors have been stimulated, beta receptors have been stimulated, and alpha and beta receptors have been stimulated. With alpha receptor, there is a peripheral vasoconstriction and pulmonary venous constriction, and that increases. But there is also platelet aggregation, microthrombi, deranged endothelium, and pulmonary permeability is increased. It also results into neurogenic pulmonary edema. And straight away, as your myocardial depression is happening, there's a contraction band necrosis, there can be a cardiogenic edema. Left ventricle ejection fraction is decreased, and patient went into shock. So, what are the recommendations to monitor these kind of patients? So, as such, recommendations have been given, but I will say that baseline cardiac assessment should be done with serial enzymes, ECG should be done, echocardiography should be done. So in our unit, we always do a baseline echocardiography in these patients, especially that these patients start improving. If a patient starts improving in day 3, day 4, their ejection fraction starts improving, their RW starts, first you thinking as a gloomy picture when the patient arrives to you, it start improving very, very rapidly. Troponin levels have been found, arrhythmias have been found. So the term which has been given to these patients, as we have already discussed, that three days monitoring, I've discussed that you need to do monitoring. So as regards hyponatremia, I said that independently hyponatremia has been associated with a cerebral infarction. So hyponatremia should not be there in these patients. We all know most of the time there are two pathologies in which we are confused, cerebral salt wasting or an SIADH. But in subarachnoid hemorrhage, typically I have seen that most of the time it is cerebral salt wasting. It is more common to have a hypothalamic dysfunction in these patients. But at the same time, if SIADH is the cause, you need not to restrict the fluid to treat this patient. Rather, use your hypertonic saline or I will say a mineralocorticoid like fludrocortisone in these patients so that hyponatremia should be covered. So fluid restriction, it has been shown in numerous studies, should not be used to treat hyponatremia. You have to enterally administer salt tablets, and early treatment with hydrocortisone or fludrocortisone you can give. You can use 3% saline solutions to correct hyponatremia as well. Now, I have discussed that you have to maintain the homeostatic environment of the brain as such as well to decrease the chances of delayed cerebral ischemia. So if your patient is having fever, now fever is most of the time, if you look at the initial it's mainly non-infectious. We have discussed that in ICH as well. But most of the time, this fever is there if the patient is poor grade and have more subarachnoid blood or an intraventricular blood. And you need to see those patients who are particularly have a risk of going into cerebral vasospasm. You need to control fever. Though in the independent studies, it has not been shown that it is going to improve the functional outcome. But I will still say and recommend that aggressive work of fever should be done. But at the same time, as we discussed last time, if there is a shivering, there is a protocol to control shivering as well. So shivering is much, much bad than the fever. So most of the time, what we use drugs. I will just straight away come to the protocol of having fever. We just rule out infectious cause. Transcranial Doppler, if it is showing vasospasm, the cerebral vasospasm itself. So early sign of fever might be a cerebral vasospasm which is happening at that time. If the velocities are rising and the patient is having fever, there is a subtle sign that the patient might going into delayed cerebral ischemia. So we use IV paracetamol in full dose. And as discussed last time, we have used a continuous infusion of diclofenac. Now coming to the anemia, I have already discussed with you that arterial oxygen content is important, and I've discussed the equation with you, which is an age-old critical care equation. So if you look at the studies, there is a recent randomized controlled trial in which they have given infused blood or crystalloids in those patients which are having anemia. They recommend giving blood and maintain a hemoglobin of at least 9 in subarachnoid hemorrhage patients, especially in those patients which are more prone to having a delayed cerebral ischemic episode. So data obtained from those prospective registries of patients with subarachnoid hemorrhage suggests that higher hemoglobin values are associated with improved outcomes after SIH. Appropriate target is still not known. We in our unit keep it at around 9. Whether transfusion is useful cannot be determined from the available data. As far as DVT prophylaxis is known, as soon as your aneurysm is secure, if the surgeon is very confident about the hemostasis, 24 to 48 hours after the craniotomy, you can start a chemical prophylaxis as regards subarachnoid hemorrhage. And in coiling, see, they are using heparin even before coiling or securing the aneurysm in a large doses. So, and then they are using intra-arterial Riopro as well, apiximab in antiplatelets when there is a clot. So, and then you say that prophylaxis of this heparin, unfractionated heparin or clexane is going to cause intracranial bleeding. It can definitely. There is a question mark. There is no class 1A evidence. But most of the time, if the patient, I will say, is not moving his leg, is a poor grade patient, you should go ahead and start chemical prophylaxis in these patients. And this statement from Neurocritical Care Society, US, also prognosticate that put the patient on pneumatic compression devices preoperatively, intraoperatively, and postoperatively, and you can start at least unfractionated heparin at least 24 hours after the aneurysm has been secured. As regards sugars, at the same, maintain it between 80 to 200. Hypoglycemia is a big no, and even hyperglycemia above 200 or 250 is a big no. Try to maintain the homeostatic environment of the brain. Hypoglycemia to be avoided. So I have just recently seen some prognostication score. There has been some prognostication score apart from the HNH scores and WFNS score, which you use to prognosticate. There is a fresh score and there is a hair score, which has been published. So there has been a lot of work which has been going on regarding the prognostication in these patients. If you look at this hair score, they have used HNH grading, age, IVH and rebleed, and they have scored it from 0 to 8. So prognostication in these patients is very, very important. One more thing I just wanted to touch before I end the slides is, see, sometimes a patient reach in ER and patient is in a bad grade because of hydrocephalus, cerebral edema, and you see the patient is M2, M3, whether we should offer the patient this kind of a treatment. If a patient has got a subarachnoid hemorrhage, see, most of the time, as soon as you put an EVD in this patient, your blood pressure, see, at the ER, your blood pressure is 200 by 100. Now, that means that should let you think that if your blood pressure is 200, that means your brain is working. Your brain is maintaining the collateral circulation in an injured brain. So don't decrease the blood pressure at that very moment. Your brain is giving your time. Go ahead, call the neurosurgeon, put an EVD. EVD will decrease the intracranial pressure, but do it slowly. A guarded manner of CSF drainage is important. And at the same time, then you start decreasing the blood pressure. So don't jump to conclusions. And you see that as soon as you put your EVD, your patient, which was M2 before, that patient has improved to M5. Now you straight away can go and secure the aneurysm after you put an EVD. So this kind of things you see more often in your clinical practice. An important thing is late hydrocephalus also is a very important prognostic factor in these patients. So most of these patients, when they put an EVD, it is difficult to remove those EVD. So try to decrease the drainage day by day, and then you stop. And at that time also, when you have stopped the EVD, try to maintain and see the intracranial pressure waves, because you have stopped draining. So you can see intermittent intracranial pressure waves. Another important thing is that once you have draining, it's you have start decreasing the CSF. Suppose if you are draining 150 ml in a day, and now you have started decreasing it to 70 ml, and you can't monitor the intracranial pressure at the same time because you are still draining, you put your transcranial Doppler probe. And if you are seeing that your PIs are increasing, that means this patient actually needs a drainage. So it's a wholesome approach for these patients. And I will always say that it is your trained neurointensivist who should take the charge of subarachnoid hemorrhage. Only rebleeding has been taken care of by the surgeon. Rest, edge and everything should be taken care of by the neurointensive care team. And it will be a smooth ride. And you see more and more poor grade patients which are coming to you, and you are going to remove those tracheostomies in coming time. So thank you very much. Over to Prasanna.
Yeah, thank you, Saurav, for that wonderful presentation and nice slides with a very well covered review of literature, and also covering your protocol of Artemis. That's wonderful to listen. So I think any more comments? There are some experts available with us in the group who have joined in. Dr. Keshav, any comments from your side?
I think it was wonderfully covered, Dr. Saurav, as usual. Nice learning and teaching your way of this, the slides also, the filmy, that is very good. One thing I would like to the residents, like, there is in the pathophysiology of SAH, the blood pressure management at different stages of the this SAH, it is very, very important. Initially, when the blood pressure, this is not coiled or it is not clipped, so your blood pressure is like 140, 160. So you have to decrease the blood pressure. Once it has been coiled or clipped, it has been secured, then you are increasing the blood pressure. And of course, you have to see the basic, the fundamental of the patient, what actually the patient was. And then you can increase the blood pressure 20 to 30% above to see that the DCI is not there, and to increase the collateral perfusion. And thereafter, to rule out the DCI, as Dr. Saurav told, in the various stages of the DCI. So that blood pressure management is very, very important.
Yeah.
So yeah. That thing I want to do. Yeah.
Dr. Anil Parak sir wants to make a comment. Yes, sir, please. Yeah.
Good morning, everyone, and excellent presentation, Saurav. And I just wanted to know what is your hemoglobin, what you like to keep in your cases, and particularly at your institute, Artemis, lower hemoglobin per sole.
No, sir. We generally used to keep, sir, if a patient is a good grade aneurysm, there are less chances of patient going into cerebral vasospasm or delayed cerebral ischemia. We generally keep at a restrictive level. No problem with a hemoglobin of 8. We don't go below 8 in subarachnoid hemorrhage at any cost. But if the patient is going to develop cerebral vasospasm, more chances of getting into cerebral vasospasm, patient has got an increased TCT velocities. We are dilating the patient every other day. So in that kind of a scenario, we generally maintain a hemoglobin of 9 in these patients. So that is how we tackle in our institute. And we don't shy away in giving a transfusion.
No, that is patients. That's the reason I asked. Thank you. Good.
Dr. Punaya?
The comorbidities. If the patient is comorbid, that also will add.
Yeah.
To the...
Yeah, ischemic heart disease and
Dr. Punaya, are you there?
Yeah,
please.
See, the one thing is about the dilemmas when we are doing TCDs regularly, sometimes you might see a patient in which the velocities will be higher, but clinically the patient will be absolutely all right, but the velocity might be touching 180, 200 and things like that. So what is the protocol? How long you keep the patient in the ICU or the step down to monitor when the patient is clinically the patient is without any deficit or the patient is absolutely okay, but there is a TCD wise there is a rise in velocity. So always we talk about picking things early. So now we have picked up something early. So there will be a dilemma for how, because the vasospasm is expected to occur up to 3 weeks. Okay, so this is one dilemma we face clinically. This should be discussed. Dr. Saurav, you have any opinion on that?
So if I can, I don't want to share my slides again. I have shown a TCD guided protocol as well. So what we do in our institution is, see, if your TCD velocities are rising and your patient is okay, so this is one set of things which is there. So that means something bad might going to happen in near future. It might not happen, but it might also happen. See, you need to look at the thing. See, if your TCD velocities are rising and your patient is still not developing a system, focal neurological deficit, that means his or her collaterals are working. His or her collaterals are working. Still, your patient doesn't develop a symptom. That means our collateral system is working and the patient doesn't develop a symptom as of now. But if your patient's TCT velocities are definitely rising, your Lindgaard ratio is also showing. See, sometimes a patient is on a hyperdynamic circulation and your TCT velocities are rising because of that. You're putting a patient on NOR-ADR and seeing that your TCT velocities are rising. So at the same time, I always said that measure the baseline. It's increasing trend. You're saying the Lindgaard ratio, it's increasing trend. Definitely in that kind of a scenario, I took my patient to a second level of investigation, whether to do a CT angiography or straight away took the patient to a digital subtraction angiography lab. I took the patient to DSA lab. If the patient is indicating a severe vasospasm criteria in transcranial Doppler, that means something bad is going to happen. I don't wait for the night. In the night, everything will be slow and morning, I will wake up with an infarct in the patient. Why not do a DSA and get away with these things?
No, but patient is asymptomatic.
Doesn't make a difference for me. It can be symptomatic in another hour or so.
No, that will be, I think there will be very, very aggressive way of treating a patient. But we don't know at this point of time whether it really improves the outcome of the patient. The second thing is that if you see the Denmark study, the European trial, as you know, in the Asia chapter also it was discussed. Even the question of taking the patient to the cath lab and doing angioplasty itself is questioned because they didn't find a major outcome benefit in these patients when we compare with the North American centers and when compared with Denmark, where they took every they don't take the patients for the cath lab. They just treat in a conservative way and they found that there was not much outcome difference. All these things are dilemmas, but thing is that one way is to treat them very, very aggressively and see, as you rightly said, whether there is evidence or no evidence. By applying precise in medicine, you just treat those patients and see how it works. The other way of treating is that treating them more conservatively, thinking that all these interventions are not, because even if you do chemical angioplasty, you must have seen And even if you do a post-op prolonged infusion of nimodipine, sometimes these effects are only very, very short-acting. And in spite of all these interventions, patient again go in for vasospasm, going for a kind of refractory vasospasm. So all these things are there. And
my take-home message will always be over-treat and not under-treat these patients. See, once that window is gone, you develop a cerebral infarction in these patients, you are gone. Your patient, which was walking yesterday, is not able to walk in her entire life now. So, if you are a high volume center, you are doing DSA regularly. And we all know it's not a high risk procedure of doing a DSA. It might be a high risk procedure and you have to call the neuro interventionist from outside. He is on a call. He comes to your institution and you are doing a DSA 4 or 5 times in a day. We are doing 4 or 5 check angiographies every day in our DSA lab. So it depends on the institution. You are perfectly fine. But if your institution is not going to support the infrastructure, don't have an infrastructure, what you can do? What I mean to say from the neuro-intensive point of care is don't sit. Don't sit on it. You should see, even if your surgeon, if your neurointerventionist is not going to take your patient to DSA lab, you manage those patients still aggressively with your hyperdynamic therapy. You still go ahead and start Milrinone. Increase the dose of Milrinone, I will say. Increase the dose of vasodilators, I will say. And then manage it more aggressively. See, this is the way we do in our institute, at least.
Yeah. One minute. Somebody has kept their mic open. I am not able to trace here. Can you mute it, please?
Prasanna, you can take questions from the chat box. So yeah. Otherwise,
list
the questions.
Yeah, yeah. So one very important question what they asked, why don't you use IV nimodipine? Why do you use oral nimodipine? Why do you prefer so much? Like one of the questions.
I will answer this. So we have used IV nimodipine in the past in 2009, 2008, 2007 to 2009. But what we have seen is that IV nimodipine is associated with significant hypotension. Even oral nimodipine has been associated with significant hypotension. Yeah. And definitely, your hypotension is going to harm your patient much, much more than what the nimodipine is going to benefit. So always, always keep that in mind that blood pressure needs to be maintained at any cost. Your blood pressure takes precedence over any drug, over any drug. So if you are giving an IV nimodipine and your blood pressure is falling, that's not good for us. So we generally give a 60 milligram fourth hourly dose of nimodipine, and if that is also causing hypotension, we reduce the dose to 30 milligram. So
at one point of time, do you completely stop nimodipine that when you want to give a induced hypertension? Okay, single
ester. We don't generally stop nimodipine. We generally don't stop unless and until it's as soon as we give the dose, it is going to cause significant hypotension in the patient. We reduce the dose to half, and if that is also causing hypotension, then we momentarily stop the drug definitely.
Okay. So what is your take on this nimodipine improving the outcomes? Because it has not shown to improve the angiographically the cerebral reduction of cerebral vasospasm, and there is some marginal benefit than the significant benefit. Do you think that 4% absolute risk reduction is marginal or a significant benefit?
I will say that if the study is going to be done today, it's going to be failed miserably.
Yeah.
Okay. So, but because in the literature, it has been described as class 1A evidence. And if you are not giving nimodipine, patient take your treatment protocol to some other hospital. They say, nimodipine, you are not starting nimodipine. You have done a big, big mistake. So as if it's going to tide over from everything, it's not. It is not a magic bullet again, I will say.
Okay. Question is, what they asked is, how frequently you monitor the patient for neurological deficit? I think it must be similar to the other patients. How frequently you monitor neurologically?
It will be much more than that. Much more than that. Another important thing is, I will always say that please give your staff the clear instruction. See, you tell them, they will monitor GCS. They are going, sir, GCS is this, GCS is fine. So GCS might still be there for a confused patient. They will say, sir, E4, V5, M6 or V4, M6. So you will also say that it's okay. But if you tell your patient has got an ACOM aneurysm, you need to tell them specifically, I'm looking for a lower limb weakness. I'm looking for a confused patient in this patient. So tell your staff correctly, at least your team leader of your nursing staff, what you are looking in these patients. So you should not miss the early signs of cerebral vasospasm.
How frequently you do the TCD in these patients?
Eighth hourly. Yeah. If the patient is going to have a dilatation, we do a post dilatation as well. And then in the evening shift, whenever we are giving rounds, we do one more. One person do it in the night as well.
Okay. What is your management protocol, Dr. Punaya?
No, pretty much similar.
Yeah.
Okay. But thing is that with respect to doing repeated angiogram, we don't go for that. So you all know there is no limit for that. If you just if you think that that is the way to go forward, then there's no limit for that. Yeah. The second thing is that again the cost factor is also there. So without a solid evidence of we cannot go for such costly interventions again and again. That is one factor. Mm. We do one or twice spasmolysis, and maybe we put them on continuous infusion, milrinone, all those stuff. Maximal medical management as much as possible. Mm. The other thing about oral nimodipine is, as rightly said, and it has been discussed in the international forums also, when we do a trial now, because it's based on one study done in 1980s, and still we are just following that. And
so because magnesium, many drugs were tried, none of have been found to be. Yeah.
So with respect to this nimodipine, especially among surgeons and other physicians, it has become like a Bible. It is a kind of one commandment that should not be questioned. So it is not that. It is not that way we have to practice medicine. We have to see the patient's individual response. Many a times we see when we give nimodipine, the BP crash, they have to put them on NORAD, they have to add vasopress, all those things.
Okay.
So why do you want to do that? In that scenario, we just withhold the dose. Otherwise, there is an option to reduce the dose to 30 milligram every second hourly. So if that doesn't work, then make it 30 milligram every fourth hourly for the sake of that study, which has been done in 1980s.
Okay. So I think the fear is more of legal in nature because it has become like a part of treatment protocol. More people are afraid that if you don't put, then legally you are bound to this one, questioned that why it was not used.
There is a question, which is the threshold for hyponatremia to trigger correction?
Yeah.
Even if neurologically patient is stable without symptoms, as frequently we find 129 to 130.
And they asked whether to use tolvaptan also.
Most of the time I have told you that it's the cerebral salt wasting which is being
okay.
And it is for a transient period of time. It is always for a transient period of time. Hmm. It generally corrects. So you know that hyponatremia has been associated with a cerebral infarction. Otherwise, also in a patient with a poor grade SH and a higher grade SH, you need to maintain the sodium levels and between 135 to 145 at least. We used to maintain that more than that in a raised ICP scenarios. So what will be your threshold? I will say the threshold will depend on the clinical condition of the patient and also depend on what stage the patient is. So I will correct a sodium of 129 if the patient is more prone to cerebral ischemia. If the patient is anemic, I will definitely go ahead and treat the patient treat the sodium level by giving salt capsules, by adding extra salt to the diet. And if that is not working, I might add a mineralocorticoid like fludrocortisone very early in the treatment chart. And that's how, if the sodium is really low, I might end up, and the patient has got a cerebral edema, I might have end up in giving hypertonic saline and monitoring sodium more frequently, like a 6 hour or a 8 hour monitoring sodium.
So this, you said this anti-epileptic drugs, a short trial, maybe 7 days or something, 3 to 7 days when the patient comes, though there is no evidence, sound evidence to it. So do you use phenytoin or levetiracetam now? Because most of the corporate world and the people who have a lot of money, they have shifted over to levetiracetam, even though there is no obvious evidence. So what do you use now, phenytoin still or levetiracetam?
See, we have shifted to levetiracetam.
Levetiracetam, okay.
Definitely. Hmm. See, I have already told that there has been a drastic change in the surgeons as well, in the neurointerventions as well from last 15 years. They were discharged on anti-epileptics, and anti-epileptics were going on for 2 years at least in these subarachnoid hemorrhage patients. Hmm. So now, at least they have shifted for a smaller interval. Definitely, to my liking, I will say that as soon as they've been discharged from the hospital, it should be stopped. But still, people used to give it in the prescription. Because in India, what happens is, if patient develop a seizure, patient go to a different hospital, they say, oh, they haven't started anti-epileptic, it's a big mistake. They have created that kind of a mistake. So surgeons most of the time are going by that thing as well. So you need to keep most of the things in the mind. So people have switched to a safer option, I will say, from phenytoin. That's why levetiracetam has been marketed well in this category.
Also, it is very costly compared to phenytoin, right?
Switch to Valproate, yeah.
Switch to Valproate.
Switch to Valproate.
So most of the people, when they want to use for a longer time, no, and where there is no patient monitoring, they feel levetiracetam has a better safety profile than phenytoin and Valproate. That's one of the reasons maybe people want to shift to levetiracetam.
So if you want to give it for a shorter period of time, then give Valproate.
See, the other question is, some users asked whether do you use hypertonic saline or mannitol routinely in post-operative period, or how do you decide what to use? Like hypertonic saline, mannitol in these patients.
We discussed this last time as well, that it depends on the patient characteristic most of the time. And if the patient is hyponatremic, patient, it depends on various things. As such, in the literature, you don't find enough evidence what to do. I will say an EVD will do more good in subarachnoid hemorrhage than starting. It's not a parenchymal disease. It's not a cerebral edema, which is, though it might develop sometimes. But most of the time,
there has to be a protocol to put an EVD. No, we can't put every case. Do you?
No. I'm not saying most of the time it is like that. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. Okay.
But yes, you can use any of them. I won't say that one agent is preferred over the other. Though in our institute, we used to go for hypertonic. We are using hypertonic saline now.
Okay. So this euolemia, you said it is very important maintaining. Okay. What are all the parameters you are using to maintain a euolemia in these cases? Like, is it only CVP, IVC? What is there any use of IVC diameter for spontaneously breathing patients, like any collapsibility index? How do you see dynamic assessment of volume status?
It is generally being important in poor grade patients.
Okay.
Those patients who are a poor grade patients, and those patients who are particularly at risk of having a low ejection fractions, the cardiac output have been decreased right from the beginning. Those patients who might have a neurogenic pulmonary edema, and at the same time, those patients who might develop high propensity to develop delayed cerebral ischemia in these patients. So you need to maintain euvolemia. What we at our institute are doing in a poor grade patient, we do put a CVP in a poor grade patient, not in a good grade patient. In a poor grade patient, we monitor IVC diameter, variability of the IVC, as well as the lung ultrasound done at the same time to know whether when we are giving the fluids, whether it is the B lines are increasing or not. Definitely, when we are going our ultrasound classes, Dr. Neeraj is going to discuss about that as well. So this is non-invasive. I'm not saying that it is a sure shot way. And at the same time, with IVC probe, you can look at the diastolic volumes as well. So overall, you look at the heart, you look at the IVC, you look at the lungs. It will definitely give you the picture whether your patient is full or empty. And arterial tracing on a patient on a ventilator, it gives you a stroke volume variation as well. Yeah. So you combine. 1 + 1 becomes 11 for you.
Yeah. Any choice of fluid for this, colloids or crystalloids? Colloids, obviously, nowadays, a lot of people are discouraging them. So
not using
plasma light, normal saline, or ringer lactate, which what do you feel?
I will say that use plasma lights or cabi lights or those. I don't want to name any company, but those you can use, but they are costly. See, these patients are there for a long term, they are costly. Yeah. And at the same time, if you are using normal saline, you are going to find hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis in these patients as well. Whether that kind of hypermetabolic acidosis is causing any harm to the patient or not, I still don't know. But definitely, what I do is, as a maintenance fluid, when generally patient is on a rise tube feeding, full rise tube feeding, I put a dose of, I put a patient on a plasma light or something like that, for a day, which is going on as a 25 to 50 ml per hour, and a single bag will do in this kind of a scenario, and not raising the hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis. You can ask other people in the panel as well what they are using.
Yes, Dr. Punaya, are you there?
Regarding?
regarding the choice of fluid and dynamic assessment of fluid status. How do you do in your patients?
Yeah. See, thing is that keeping the patient full might help in improving the oxygen delivery to the brain and thereby alleviating the symptoms of delayed cerebral ischemia. But thing is that we need to think, is there a perfect way to do that? And is there a perfect way to measure that? Okay. So there is no absolute perfect way to measure, or there is no absolute perfect way to achieve that target. Because we can say keep the patient full or keep the patient euvolemia thing. When you give fluid, obviously the body also will react. It redistributes. The patient passes urine, it redistributes the interstitial thing. Here we need to think more about the harm. The patient's lungs are going to get congested. The lung, they are going to develop a lot of B lines. So we have to be very careful about that. So, okay. So that is the reason why hypervolemia, because non-physiological goals are always dangerous. Hypervolemia is non-physiological. So that is why it went out of the armamentarium. So maintaining hypertension, it is also non-physiological. We are straining the heart and trying to maintain hypertension. And more importantly, we have to increase the cardiac output. In poor grade aneurysm, especially when the patient is intubated and when mechanically ventilated and controlled ventilation.
The question is about the choice of fluids. What kind of fluid
both,
you are using?
Both I asked him. Yeah, choice of fluids.
Choice of fluid, what is the doubt in that? It's obviously crystalloids.
Okay, no, in that RL, NS or any plasma light like that thing.
Doesn't like matter. You might argue for plasma light or something, but for me, it doesn't matter. See, obviously, these patients, some of the patients develop a hyponatremia. At that time, you start obviously using 3% NS. So, what's the harm in giving 3% NS? It should be patient specific. You know, if the patient is sodium, everything is fine, then plasma light, whatever theoretical benefit it offers, it's good. Any crystalloid will do, I think. The thing is that you have to monitor the electrolytes and you have to.
It's cheap as well. It is cheap as well.
Okay.
I think all these types of fluids and other things are just only the theoretical questions and for researchers to study and come out with the non-conclusive evidences. But
as of now, we cannot say like that. Tomorrow may the evidence which is absent today, tomorrow may it may come.
That's up. What I'm saying now. The evidence will come, but still will be non-conclusive. That's the word I use, because it's very difficult to prove such an intervention is going to have a outcome on the patients when there are multifactorial things involved in the patients. So all these things, it has to be left to the individual practitioner's choice. Unless it doesn't cause a major harm, it can be used. Because normal saline and other things has been used for so many years. And you might come up with a paper saying that it causes renal injury. But thing is that there are a lot of factors which are involved in perioperative renal injury. Even this contrast, it has been now said that there is nothing called a contrast-induced nephropathy. Because there are so many factors involved in acute kidney injury when the patient is in the hospital stay.
To cut down on fluids, we can start the feed early in these patients as well. So we can reduce the days and the therapy of this fluid as well. And Dr. Prasanna has also come out with evidence on this.
It is not this tomorrow. The evidence may come. Okay, so
what about, can you discuss your study also that
Dr. Keshav said, this fluid is only for a very short period of time during the perioperative course and first 48 to 72 hours. After that, these patients are the well-to-do patients, good grade patients, they eat and they take up oral liquids, or if the patient is intubated, they directly go for enteral feeding.
During that period only we were discussing what is any specific choice of fluid. Obviously, it is left to the individual patient, so we wanted to know the different views on that. It is not that we are compelling somebody to use any of the newer one and older one. And there is a price difference is also not much, as when you can take a suspected patient for a TCD or TCD charges or a lab, cath lab, the choice, the fluid rate is not much compared to that. Let us leave it off that. One more, because there is no, you cannot have a conclusion on that, obviously.
No, when you go to fill petrol, always you ask power or ordinary petrol. So like
ordinary that. Is okay. Ordinary is okay.
No, obviously, the price difference is not much, I would say. 2 rupees. So I put the power petrol. So it is depends on the personal. Let us leave it at that. The other question is, this DVT profile axis, you said that after 24 hours, we can start heparin low dose. Do you actually do that?
See, most of our patients have been coiled. Okay. So, in when they are using coiling and they are using unfractionated heparin, and we are keeping an ACT of around 300 during coiling before they secure the aneurysm. Okay. After they have secured the aneurysm, why can't we give unfractionated heparin and continue unfractionated heparin in a prophylactic dose? Still, I will say that you need to see few things in that. What few things is that? See, during coiling, sometimes the aneurysm is not completely secured. Sometimes it is still filling at the end when they have taken the angiogram. And they say that, okay, it is going to thrombose once the effect of heparin is going to wear off. Okay. So it's eventually it's going to be thrombosed, and we are seeing in the check angiogram, but they're not very confident of that. In that case of a scenario, you can actually wait. Second important thing, how is your patient? Your patient is a good grade patient. He is anyway going to ward next day, and you are starting mobilizing the patient in a good grade aneurysm. But especially in a poor grade patient, in which we have coiled the patient, especially in patients which has got leg weakness in them preoperatively. So in those patients, we should start chemo prophylaxis early. And there has been an evidence, and if we look at the Neurocritical Care Society guidelines on chemo prophylaxis of all the neuro patients, like an ICH, SH and everything, they actually recommend starting it as soon as you secure the aneurysm within 24 hours, after 24 hours. In our practice, we wait for 48 hours and then we generally start, and it depends on the patient profile as well. Definitely not in every patient we are going to start it at after 48 hours. Yes, IPC will be there, but chemo prophylaxis.
Post-surgical patients, aneurysm clipping.
Yeah, if the surgeon is very confident about the hemostasis, you can start after 48 hours.
What do you do, Dr. Punaya?
See, if the patient is at high risk for DVT, then obviously pharmacological prophylaxis has to be started. The patient risk factor is low. The patient is easily ambulated, good grade aneurysm, is walking around. Then those patients does not need any specific DVT prophylaxis.
We are talking of the patient who require only, like a poor grade. You take it as a
who require their need. You have to give, because this is not a contraindication. The SAH aneurysm has been secured. It's not a contraindication. See, when you are going to raise the blood pressure post surgery, that is the highest risk. If the patient is aneurysm is not secured properly, then it may give away. Okay, this if the patient is higher risk for thrombal prophylaxis, immediately after 24 hours we can start low molecular heparin. We don't use unfractionated heparin because low molecular heparin is, you know, easier to use, and it's a good safety profile than unfractionated heparin. So we always go for low molecular heparin.
Okay. I think one question the Dr. Anil Parakh has asked. Yes, sir, you can ask directly.
Yeah, no, I just wanted, once I have seen like two aneurysms, we could coil one. What is any management change on the blood pressure, something different? That's I wanted your opinion.
See, sir, that question has been typically, if you look at the AHA guidelines of 2012, that was the specific question asked. Even in the neurocritical care guidelines, they have asked that there are multiple aneurysms and you have treated the one which you think that has caused the subarachnoid hemorrhage, that has caused the bleed. You have treated that patient. Rest of the aneurysms are still unruptured and in the system. So they say if the patient require a hyperdynamic therapy in these patients, because that the patient is going into cerebral vasospasm, there is no contraindication. You can give hyperdynamic therapy in these patients. There is no contraindication that there is an aneurysm present and that can rupture. Though theoretical risk is there, the recommendation is still 2B, if I remember correctly. I might be wrong. I will send you the link of those guidelines. But still, they clearly say that focus on the aneurysm which has been ruptured. You have to focus on that management per se. So you can go for your blood pressure augmentation, though slowly and steadily, and you can do that.
Thank you.
Okay. I think we have completed most of the questions. So the only issue what happened today is I lost the this video recording for some 2 minutes of time. So I have now two different video recordings. I have to join and upload in our channel. So that I will do it, and maybe 1 or 2 days it will be available to you, and the link will be sent to you.
I have asked the role of IV dextran in DCI.
Yeah.
Anybody using? We are not using it.
No, I don't think anybody is using.
Anybody in the panel who is using IV dextran?
So the question is asked by whoever has asked can unmute and give this one. I think no. Okay.
No, we have used for reimplantation sometime in the limbs and all, but not in the
aneurysm. Yeah. So not many people are using that. Okay, then thank you, Dr. Saurabh, for the excellent presentation. So next week we will meet with something new topic, and maybe if you are bored of Saurabh, we can choose a different speaker also. Do let us know what you want.
He can never board us. He can never board us.
Okay.
I'm missing his Artemis conference this year.
Yeah, this though we wanted to have the Neurocritical Care Society of India first annual conference in Artemis. We will do it. That is our promise. Okay, thank you, Dr. Saurabh, for the wonderful presentation, and I'll stop the recording now, and you can go through it again when we share the link. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Saurabh.